Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Welcome to Colonial Heights Church. You know, I've been here a little over 7 years, and whenever I stand up here, I still have to think, say the right church name. I think once or twice since I've been here, I've answered the phone, hello, Langley Christian. Oh, wait, that's that other church. Good to see you today. And good to see those of you who are online with us. And one of the great things about it being online is that, after church, you can go home and watch it all over again.
Yeah. No.
Some might, yeah. It's like, what did that crazy preacher say? Well, let's stand together and let's pray, and then we'll turn it over to the lovely and delightful Sharon and John. And by the way, today is John's birthday.
Happy birthday.
Yes.
Happy birthday.
So, and how old are you today, John?
Oh, man. How old am I? 27 years old.
27. Ooh.
I feel the prints in my knees, man.
Yeah, just wait until you really get older. But anyways, Lord God, thank you for being with us today. You promised that where two or three are gathered in your name, there you are in their midst. So thank you, Lord, for being with us. Help us, Father, to open our hearts and our minds so that the songs and the message and the singing of the songs will touch our hearts and playing of the songs as well. Help us, Father, so that the meditations and the prayers and the sermon will lift us up and will touch our hearts. We'll be more able to draw near to you and to draw others to you as well. Thank you, Father, for each one who is here. May we honor you and glorify your name. In Christ we pray, amen.
Good morning and welcome. Welcome, everyone. Join us as we sing to our Savior Christ Jesus.
Angels, we have heard. Thank you.
Christians to show the light that Christ has given us in our life, to shine forth in a dark world. But many people ask me, what does it mean to be a light in a dark world? What is this light? People say, well, let your light shine forth, be soft and light. All these things we have in reference to the Bible are being light. Are they talking about turning on a light bulb and just carrying it around? I got my light, it's on. I got the light check. Is that the light talking about?
No.
Or when you're driving down the street and the headlight beams, oh, he got me brightly. Is that the type of light?
No.
Or we're talking about the light that shines out of grace and love from heaven. Like on a stormy day when it breaks through the clouds. It's just overpowering and changes everything around it. If you go into a dark room and you take one candle and you light it, it can be seen anywhere in the room, dark room. One candle, two candles, three candles, four. The more light you shine, the brighter it is in the dark world. We are candles, every one of us, who name Christ as their Lord and Savior. We shine our light forth. We're shining bright in the dark world. With one candle, two candle, three candle, four. The more candles, the better. But it only takes one candle to shine light in a dark area. We have our own cavities of darkness in our lives. We, our Christians, are sent to go to the lost and be a light, to be a beacon, so they can be found. Right? We turn the light to see things that are lost in the dark. God says that we are lost in the dark. The Old Testament tells us that the whole time that judgment's coming, he's going to see the light of the world. Jesus is that light. I'd like to read from John 1, starting from John 1:1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning.
Through him, all things were made. Without him, nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and the life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. We are light in the Christian age, and there's darkness out there everywhere. We all have the opportunity to shine where we're at, for the people we're around, the people we love. Touch their lives. The holiday season upon us. Let your light shine in a dark world. Tell the lost about Jesus. What he did for them is more just the present than the tree. Jesus is the present. He is the light of the world. Share your faith with the lost around you. You may be the only light they ever see. Let's give the Lord in prayer. Gracious Lord, Father, help us. We are utterly and totally lost without you. Help us to find the light switch in Jesus' name, that we can shine forth one light, two lights, three lights, four. That we share our faith, that we grow in numbers, that we love one another as you call us to do, Lord. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. As Christians, we need a life that people see, because we shine like lights in the dark. When we shine forth our light as Christians, we don't claim to be perfect. We don't claim to have all the answers. What we claim to have is salvation. Salvation in the name of Jesus Christ. To take us, a broken vessel, from where we are to where we need to be. An empty, broken vessel that God fills with his love, with his joy, his compassion, his generosity. And then teaches us how to reflect that back in a world that's also broken. And when they see a broken vessel helping another broken vessel, and helping each other, and making a difference, isn't that partly what we're supposed to do as Christians? To seek out other people, to meet their needs, have compassion on the lost, the sick, and the hurt. We don't have to go halfway around the world to find these things. We can find next door, at our job, at our neighbor, at the grocery store, the gas station, the man standing on the corner. We have so many opportunities to let our light shine. I'd like to continue from John 21, starting in verse 12. Yet all those who did receive him, to those who believe in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision, nor of human will, but born of God. When we give, whether it be financially, whether it be for our services, whether it be helping a brother out who's in need, we are doing what God calls us to do. We are allowing Christ to shine forth in our life. His light to emulate around us, to be a bright light
in a dark world, whether you're one candle or two, whether 1,000 watts or 1 watt, as long as you let your light shine for Christ, to be an example, and speak nothing, and we're doing His will. Give to God, and God will give to you. We give out of our love, and God gives out of His love to us, whether financially, whether through a job, or a service. Whatever we do, give it unto the Lord. With faith and love, and He'll return it. Press down. It's just cannot give God. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Gracious Lord, we thank You for the example that You give us in the Word of Your love, the example You give us of generosity and giving, of taking us as we are to where we need to be. Love us as we are, and help us to overcome what we've been in our lives. Father, we thank You for this, for the holiday season that we have Jesus. Baby Jesus came to the world perfect. And Father, You gave Him as an example for us to follow. We love You, Lord, and thank You for the Christmas season, for those who are around us, Lord, and for those who give to the church and to support Your kingdom. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Well, thank you, Robert. We're going to do some announcements in just a moment. But first, I'd like to kind of take off on what Robert said about the offering. Great thoughts. Over the last year, a little bit less, we've seen a lot of inflation. Inflation is a two-edged sword. The negative side is you look at gas prices and utilities and food and lots of other things, prices go up. But I also know that first of the year, a lot of people are going to start receiving more money based on the rate of inflation. And now, I try not to meddle, because what you give is between you and God. Here's my point. A few months ago, we sent a letter asking people to prayerfully consider the situation for the church, and I hope that you continue to pray for the church, and ask you to consider your personal giving. And some people were able to give a lump sum type of gift. Other people have probably increased their offerings week by week or month by month. I don't see what comes in the offering, so I don't know who's increased or whatever. I just say, praise God. And we've gone from being about out of money to where we've had some good offerings, and we're doing okay right now. But I hope that you're still praying for the church, praying for your own giving and such. And the reason for the timing of this is, if you're in a situation where your income goes up, at any point, but especially first of the year, consider your giving to the Lord, whether to this church or other ministries or whatever. And it might be that somebody that hasn't felt like they've been able to give, maybe they can start giving a couple dollars or $5 a week or a month or whatever. You see, it's not about the number of dollars. It's about our hearts being faithful to God. And so please pray about this and do what God tells you to do. And if it seems like it's kind of painful at first, I think you'll see God's blessing, exactly as Robert said. God gives back. He blesses us in many ways. Now, it's not that if you give $10, God's going to give you $10 back or $20 or $50. We know better than that. But there might be other blessings. You might have some bills that are suddenly a little bit lower or whatever. I don't know what happens. All I know is that 40-some years ago, Sharon and I, before we even met, we had decided that we were going to give to God. And then when we got married, we have maintained that. And we've seen God's blessing in so many ways in our lives. And I want you to have those blessings as well. So continue to pray. Continue to let God lead. And give as God shows you is the right thing to do. All right. Now to the more traditional announcements. Bibles. We have Bibles out on the cart out there in the foyer. I took the Bibles that were in the box up here and the ones that were left. There's about 6 Bibles out there. I'm hearing that there are at least a couple people who need giant print Bibles. And so we're going to try to see if we can get some of those also. And the Bibles out there, and there's quite a wide variety, everything from the Amplified Bible to the King James Study Bible out there. So anyways, if you know somebody that would like a Bible for Christmas, take one of those and give it to them. Hopefully they'll use it. Immediately after church today, we will have a congregational meeting, and everyone who's a member of the church at least 18 years of age are encouraged to stay. Hopefully you'll stay. Let's just and it's an election meeting for trustees, and hopefully you've noticed the posted ballot that's been out there for the last week, and are prayerfully considering. This coming Saturday will be food pantry and clothes closet. Ladies, anything else needs to be said about food pantry, clothes closet from 9 to 11 this Saturday? Please come out and help. Please come out and get food. Bring your friends, send your neighbors, whatever. Christmas Eve at 6 p.m. is our Christmas Eve service, and the ladies are going to be sharing. And we're going to have a good service, a good time together. Again, invite your neighbors, your friends, your enemies, whoever's around you. And those might be all the same people, you know. Relatives, friends, and enemies all might be about the same. We will have Wednesday evening Bible study this week, and then we'll take a couple weeks off at the holidays. So the 22nd, 29th, we'll not have Bible study. And then we'll pick back up with January 5th, and January 7th will be our next Defending the Faith. So those things are all coming up in the next month. Any other announcements? What did I miss? If you'd like to turn in your Bible to 1 Thessalonians chapter 3. And there's all kinds of Bibles here today. Oh yeah, go ahead, kids. There's all kinds of Bibles, from printed Bibles to electronic Bibles. I think that's great. And it used to be, if you remember, 10 years ago, if somebody had their phone out during church, everyone's like, oh, I can't believe they're going to have their phone. They're playing a game, I got a text message. But today, you can play a game and you can text message and just say, hey, I've got my Bible open. 1 Thessalonians 3:12. By the way, one of the reasons I love my electronic Bible is that I probably have between 30 and 50 different translations that I can just flip. And if I want to know what the King James Version says, I can either ask Chaz or I can turn to the King James in my Bible, electronic Bible. It's really cool. I also keep an interlinear study Bible on my phone apps, and that's called Bible Hub, the one that I use. So there's lots of great things that you can do with the electronic Bibles. You can also go to the YouVersion Bible, and you can look up the sermon notes for today. Just go to Live Events or Events and put in our zip code here, although you're sitting here, so it's probably going to come up with our church first in those notes. So you've heard me announce this a number of times over the years. I love doing it. It's like practicing my sermon, something I rarely do or have done in the past. But it's also an opportunity for people to kind of keep up with what's going on. And you can even tell when I get away from my notes, you know, because that's not in the YouVersion doesn't change when I change. 1 Thessalonians 3:12 is a verse that I've been looking forward to preaching for a long time here. Not that I've avoided it. It's just that this is the right time and the right opportunity. And take a look at the NIV, 1 Thessalonians 3:12. May the Lord make your love increase and overflow for each other and everyone else, just as ours does for you. The subject is love. The subject is love. May your love increase and overflow for everyone. Because Paul says, we love you, and our love abounds and overflows. And when I looked at the King James, the English Standard Version, I saw that word abound in there. The King James, and the Lord make you to increase and abound in love one toward another and toward all men, even as we do toward you. English Standard, and may the Lord make you increase and abound in love for one another and for all as we do for you. They all sound pretty similar, don't they? Well, they're supposed to. And then I went to the New American Standard, expecting to find something a little bit different. I did not. My New American Standard says, and may the Lord make you increase and abound in love for one another and for all as we do for you. It sounds exactly the same, doesn't it? a couple words here and there, little words different, but basically you've got abound, overflow, increase, words like that. And I was looking for a different word. But I'd fooled myself into thinking it was here, but it was not. And so I went down a few verses, down into just into the next chapter, 1 Thessalonians 4:1, and I see this. Finally then, brothers and sisters, we request and urge you in the Lord Jesus that as you received instruction for us as to how you ought to walk and please God, just as you actually do walk, that you may excel still more. That's what I was looking for. That's what I thought was in 3:12, and it wasn't there, not in any of the translations. I even looked it up in the Greek, and it wasn't there either, except that the word excel in 4:1 and the word abound in 3:12, or overflow, is from the same root word. So I feel justified. Yeah, I know. It was a stretch. Now, why do I like the word excel so much? Well, first of all, when I see the word excel, it shows purpose and it shows action. And I guess abound or overflow could be the same. But to me, if you're going to excel at something, you're going to work at it, you're going to try to do it, you're going to make sure you do it. And the word excel starts with E. And since I'm preaching the letter E this year, I had to have an E word, so. But I love this notion, this idea of excelling in love. This idea of getting past or going over and above what other people, normal people, people who are not as committed to Christ as hopefully we are, what they might do or not do. Because love is so significant. It opens doors that nobody else and nothing else can open. And there are lots of times that when we do loving things and we excel at love, other people will take notice and they'll say, what's wrong with you? Or what's right with you? Or what do you have that I don't have? And I think back on my friend Dan. A lot of you have met Dan, heard him preach, whatever. I think about when he came to Christ. And I think about how he went from bowling on Sunday mornings to coming to church. And that's a long story. I'm not going to take the time to tell the whole thing. But I just happened to be in New York when he was on a break from bowling. I guess I'm telling the whole thing, aren't I? And he came to church with me, and he came to some youth group outings with me. And during one of the first church services he was ever in, he got up during the sermon, tromped out into the aisle over everybody's feet, Dad's a big boy, and came down the aisle, and the elder who was preaching is like speechless. What do I do now? And I said, Dad, why did you come forward? And he said, you guys have something that I need. And I came up to find out what it was. Now, they took him back and they baptized him, and he came up out of the water and said, what? Why'd you do that? Needed a little bit more instruction before that, maybe. But there was love in that youth group. Now, there was pettiness and there was bickering, and I mean, we had lots of cousins in that group. They didn't always get along and whatever. But he saw the love of Christ. Had to find out what it was. Had to have that in his life. And so when we as believers excel or abound or overflow or whatever word you want to use, so we need to accept the challenge to excel still more, to overflow in love, so that what we have in Christ can be seen by the world, because the world, as Robert said, is a dark place, and the love of Jesus can show and shine in ways that maybe we underestimate sometimes. Let's take a look at 1 Thessalonians 3:6-4:2. And when Paul wrote this letter, he didn't stop and say, all right, let me start the fourth chapter now. That wasn't for maybe 1,000 years that they finally divided into chapters and verses. I don't know the whole history of that right offhand. But to understand that we don't have to see a stop sign there when we come to the end of a chapter. Let's start with 1 Thessalonians 3:6, and we'll read till we're done. But Timothy has just now come to us from you, the Thessalonians, to Paul and Silas, and has brought good news about your faith and love. He has told us that you always have pleasant memories of us and that you long to see us, just as we also long to see you. Therefore, brothers and sisters, in all our distress and persecution, we were encouraged about you because of your faith. Now we really live, since you are standing firm in the Lord. How can we thank God enough for you in return for all the joy we have in the presence of God because of you? Night and day we pray most earnestly that we may see you again and supply what is lacking in your faith. Now may our God and Father himself and our Lord Jesus clear the way for us to come to you. May the Lord make your love increase and overflow for each other and for everyone else, just as ours does for you. May he strengthen your hearts so that you will be blameless and holy in the presence of our God and Father when our Lord Jesus comes with all his holy ones. As for other matters, this is verse 1 of chapter 4. As for other matters, brothers and sisters, we instructed you how to live in order to please God, as in fact you are living. Now we ask you and urge you in the Lord Jesus to do this more and more, to excel even more, for you know what instructions we gave you by the authority of the Lord Jesus. Paul went to Thessalonica. We could look at Acts chapter 17. We're not going to take the time to turn to that right now. But Paul went. There was a synagogue there. He went and he preached. Some people got interested in the message. Some learned more about Jesus. Some came to Christ. And some were jealous because Paul was taking away some of their people. And I don't know if they were afraid that it would look bad on them or take away from the money that they had coming in or whatever it was. They were angry. And so a mob was formed and a riot was executed. Do you execute riots? I don't know. Anyways, there was a riot. And Paul and Silas ended up going down the road. In the riot, some people were beaten. And it wasn't Paul and it wasn't Silas and it wasn't Timothy, but it was some of the new converts there. And they dragged one guy out of his house and beat him and said to the magistrates, "Hey, see what we're doing here? You better make those guys leave. These are the guys that came and they changed the whole world." Boom, boom, boom. During the night, Paul and Silas went down the road, Timothy with them. Later on, Paul was praying for them constantly, and he sent Timothy back. And he was concerned that because of the persecution, because of the distress, that these new Christians would abandon the faith. But they didn't. They didn't. They stayed strong in Christ. And look what Paul says to them. He says there in 3:6, Timothy has come to us now and has brought us good news about your faith and love. Now you'll notice that he comments a little bit farther down in the passage about both of those, doesn't he? He says, we look forward to coming back so that we can add what might be missing in your faith. And we want you to be able to abound, overflow, increase, excel in your love for one another. Now, friends, if I thought that every one of us here in this place and at the sound of my voice was a perfect and complete and mature Christian who had all knowledge and all application of faith and love, I wouldn't be preaching this sermon today. And I was going to say, I don't know about you, but I do know about you and I know about me. And that is that I can still grow in my faith, that I can still learn more from the Word and increase in the way that the Spirit is able to work in me. And I can submit myself more to Him so that He can use me more to touch other people's lives and all these kinds of things. Now, if you're disappointed in me, well, you haven't been paying attention because I've acknowledged this a lot of times over the years I've been preaching here. And I mean it with every fiber of being that I have. Because I need more of Jesus to shine in my life way too much of the time. And I need to be able to excel still more in both faith and love. Now, today we're going to talk a lot more about love. Another time we can talk about faith. But we need to have Jesus in us more and more. And so when Timothy comes back, he gives good news to Paul and Silas. And Paul's like, yeehaw! Yeah! They haven't quit. They were not dissuaded by the rogues and the mobs and, you know, the religious leaders who are supposed to know better and do better about helping people with faith and love. But look at the way they behaved. And I have to tell you, I've talked with enough people who have left churches about the way many churches behave to wonder, well, no, I don't wonder. I was going to say why anybody goes to church, but I know why. Because we need what Jesus has, and we need to be witnesses of his. And that means making an intentional effort to learn more about him, to encourage and be encouraged when we're together in worship of him. All these things that we need from him. So they saw what they needed to see, that these folks were still in the Lord, and that they could grow in their faith and grow in their love. Well, there are three words or three kinds of love that are kind of highlighted in the New Testament. And actually, there are four Greek words for love. The word storge is more of a family love, and I guess you could make a case for that concept in the New Testament pretty easily. But let's look at the other three. The first word is eros. The word eros, we get our word erotic from that. It is passion. It is sexual love. Some have suggested it's more of a selfish or self-seeking love. I'm not sure that that's what the Bible intends by that word. But we need passion and we need sex. The next generation depends on it, and stronger marriages depend on that and such. So the word eros, an example of that is in Song of Solomon. If you've ever read Song of Solomon, if you've ever seen somebody reading Song of Solomon, they kind of blush a little bit with some of the thoughts that are in it. You know what? It's a great passage. I think it's especially wonderful for a husband and wife to read it to each other. I mean, anybody can read it, learn from it. There are some who believe that Song of Solomon is more of a metaphor or almost a parable for what the church is, about God's love for his people. Honestly, I think it's both. I think it is a celebration of married love, of sexuality and such. But the word eros is a word that is used in the Bible, that concept especially. The second word is the word phileo or philios. And this is the word for friendship love. For example, Philadelphia. Literally, it means city of brotherly love. Yes, sir, I have. Yes, sir. And I can give you the theory behind it, but no, I've been to Philadelphia. Oh, yes. Somebody cracked that bell. I mean, you know. No, I got, you know, they talk about Philly cheesesteaks, you know. Well, there are at least three restaurants that claim to be the originators of that, and two of them are right across from each other. And we went to both of them. You know, as a family, there were like 20 of us, so some of us went one, the other we met in the middle. And the guy that was in the one that I went to just screamed at me because I didn't order fast enough. It's almost like if you've seen the episode of Seinfeld with the soup Nazi, this guy was the cheesesteak Nazi. So no, that was in Philadelphia. So no, I understand. I've seen the way they drive too.
You go to pass, just run up the room and yell cheese whip and get out of the way.
Yeah. I actually, the last time I was probably in Philly itself, I was riding with a guy who was from Philly, and the look on his face changed as we got into Philadelphia. It was hilarious. My wife's seen the same change in me when we go into New York, but that's another set of stories. We're talking about love here, so. Yeah, the idea of friendship love is that we have friends. We care about our friends. We want to help them. And there are a couple passages, a couple verses that I want to mention. Why is it jumping? Take a look at John 13, 34 and 35. A new command I give you, love one another as I have loved you. So you must love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples if you love one another. Now, the funny thing is about me using this passage. Hello, how you folks doing? Good. And that is that the word philios is not used in this passage, but you'll notice the emphasis on love one another, that type of friendship and caring about one another. Colossians 4 is another passage. Tychicus will tell you all the news about me. He is a dear brother, a faithful minister, and a fellow servant in the Lord. I'm sending him to you for the express purpose that you may know about our circumstances and that he may encourage your hearts. He mentions somebody else here. He is coming with Onesimus, our faithful and dear brother, who is one of you. They will tell you everything that is happening here. Now, the funny thing is that Onesimus was a runaway slave. And Paul was sending him back to the master that he ran away from. Now, in talking about this, we're not endorsing slavery, and Paul was not endorsing slavery. There were just facts of that age that there were slaves and masters, and Paul encourages them to behave like Christians when they're in that situation. But Onesimus was coming back to an uncertain reception, shall we say. But Paul sent Tychicus to help out with this, and he enlists the help of the Colossian elders to help with it as well. But notice the way that Paul speaks about Tychicus here. Tychicus will tell you the reasons about me. He is a dear brother, faithful minister, and fellow servant. There's obviously an appreciation for who Tychicus was as a growing Christian, as a servant of the Lord helping Paul. Well, the third word is the one that, I guess fourth word in this case, since we mentioned storge earlier, is the word agape. And I find it kind of funny when I see a church that uses that word in its title, you know, the Agape Lutheran Church or whatever, because on a sign, it looks like agape. And if somebody is agape, they're like, you know? Anyways, they say little things amuse little minds, and that tells you where I stand. Most of the time in the Bible, in the New Testament, when you see the word love, it's the word agape. And the word agape stems from God's love. It takes on the character of the way that God loves us. That's the goal. That's the plan. That's the idea, is that we are going to love others the way that God loves us. Okay, you got somebody you need to forgive? Guess what? You've already received forgiveness from God. Give them the forgiveness like you've received from him. That's agape. That is God at work in and through us. And sometimes it angers us. Okay, sometimes it angers me. I don't want to forgive them. I like feeling angry. But it feels so good after I do things God's way and forgive that person. Did they deserve my forgiveness? Many times not. Many times they've not even apologized or acknowledged that they did something. Especially people driving down the road, you know, they cut you off, they never come back and apologize. What's wrong with people? I don't want them to come back. John 3:16 and 17 is one of the best known verses in the whole Bible, right? For God so
loved the
world. Another way to translate that is, for God loved the world in such a way. That word so does not imply so much as the way that God loves, that he would send his son so that when we believe in him, we will not perish but have everlasting life. Because God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but so that the world might be saved through him. That's the 17th verse. Every bit as important as the 60th. How about John 15:9-14? Tell me if you've ever heard this passage. Jesus says, as the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. He uses that word agape. Now remain in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will remain in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commands and remain in his love. I have told you this so that my joy may be in you and your joy may be complete. My command is this, love each other as I have loved you. Now here's Jesus speaking to his disciples. Here's Jesus in the last hours of his earthly life and ministry. And he talks to them about the work of the Holy Spirit. He talks to them about peace. He talks about relationship with the Father, and he talks about love, many other things as well. My command is this, love each other as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You're my friends if you do what I command. I think we get the idea, right? If I'm going to go through this world and be a servant of Christ, I'm going to strive to love others the way he loves me. I'm going to do my best day in and day out, even people who don't deserve his love or mine. But especially if I want to make an impact on my world for Christ, then I'm going to take seriously, love each other as I have loved you, and the opportunity to lay down my life for others. Well, let's look at some other passages here. Let's look at 1 Peter chapter 4, 7 through 10. The end of all things is near. Wait a minute. I'm supposed to be reading about love. Therefore, be alert and of sober mind so that you may pray. Where's the love? Oh, here it comes. Above all, love each other deeply, because love covers a multitude of sins. Offer hospitality to one another without grumbling. Each of you should use whatever gift you have received to serve others as faithful stewards of God's grace in its various forms. If anyone speaks, they should do so as one who speaks the very words of God. If anyone serves, they should do so with the strength God provides, so that in all things God may be praised through Jesus Christ. To him be glory and power forever and ever. Amen. So, what is Peter saying? He says, hey guys, we don't know how much longer this world is going to last. It might be this much time, it might be this much time. But what we know is that we need to take seriously our walk in the Lord. Therefore, love each other deeply. Love covers a multitude of sins. Now, I wish Peter would have added a few more words here. The Holy Spirit did not inspire him to do so. Whose sins get covered? Is it because I love, I help you to receive forgiveness from Christ and from me, if that's appropriate, or others? Is it my sins that you're going to forgive? Or what? Now I see why Peter didn't add any words. Because we all make mistakes. We all have shortcomings. We all have times that we proverbially step on other people's toes or all the way up their legs. And it's an opportunity to forgive. It's an opportunity to involve God in our relationship together. Sometimes it's going to the Word and helping people to understand what God's Word says about their particular sin. Sometimes you need to help me to see what I'm missing in God's Word or by the way I'm living my life, all these kind of things. I want you to notice here, and not only says love covers a multitude of sins, but he talks about the use of love. He speaks about hospitality. Now, what is hospitality? It's opening up your home or in some other way helping somebody else. And there have been opportunities that I've seen in Christians to take a homeless person and take them to a restaurant and buy them a hamburger or whatever and get a chance to talk to them. I've seen people that would, when guests came to church, they would automatically invite them to go out to eat with them or to their home for dinner in some cases. I've seen lots of ways that people have used hospitality as a way of showing love. Later down in the passage, he talks about serving one another. That's a form of love also, isn't it? You know, there are lots of opportunities that way. Well, how about 1 Corinthians 13? Are you surprised to hear that in a sermon about love? 1 Corinthians 13, if I speak in the tongues of men and of angels, but do not love, I am only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have faith that can move mountains, but do not love, I am nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor and give over my body to hardship, that I may boast but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It does not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. Love always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails. I've seen sermons and lessons where the preacher or teacher has said, okay, put your own name in there, in that middle part of the passage. Matt is patient. Not always. Matt is kind. Always tries. Matt does not envy. Well, now, feel free to put your name in there, even if your name's not Matt. That's me, by the way. You know, to be the things that Christ wants us to be, it strengthens our relationships and it shows the love of Jesus in and through us. We'll come back to this passage later. 1 John is an amazing little book, 5 chapters, and I don't know that the first chapter talks about love, but I think all the other ones do. 1 John 2:7-11, he gives a riddle. Dear friends, I'm not writing you a new command, but an old one, which you have had since the beginning. This old command is the message you have heard, yet I am writing you a new command. Its truth is seen in him and in you, because the darkness is passing and the true light is already shining. Anyone who claims to be in the light but hates a brother or sister is still in the darkness. Anyone who loves their brother and sister lives in the light, and there is nothing in them to make them stumble. But anyone who hates a brother or sister is in darkness and walks around in the darkness. They do not know where they are going because the darkness has blinded them. The riddle. It's new, and yet it's old. What is it? Well, it's love. I believe the first time it was in the book of Leviticus, where it says, love your neighbor as yourself. Now, how did they look at love? Love is not always emotion. Obviously, it's not always romance or passion. A lot of times, love is simply caring about another person. And to see the way that God cares for us, and that care is not just, I care about you, it's deeper. It's trying to help. It's trying to resolve difficulties or whatever. I find it interesting that the verses right after the riddle, he uses the word hate a lot more than he uses the word love there, doesn't he? Anyone who claims to be in the light but hates a brother or sister still in the darkness. You know, the things that bother me about 1 John are not the things I don't understand, it's the things I do. Because when I see that verse, if I hate somebody, and by hate it's rejecting them, it's ignoring them, it's not caring about their needs and their situations, if I'm found to be hateful, then that means I'm not in the light. I'm not walking with Jesus. Wow. That's what it says. Let's go to the third chapter. 1 John 3:11-18. For this is the message you have heard from the beginning. We should love one another. Do not be like Cain, you know, that guy from Genesis 3 and 4 and whatever. Do not be like Cain, who belonged to the evil one and murdered his brother. That's probably good advice. You know, if you want to be thought a Christian or Christ-like, don't murder people. But what did Jesus say about murder? He said that if you speak evil, you know, you've heard it said, thou shalt not murder. And yet, if you hate someone, if you treat them as though they're worthless, if you call them an empty head, that's literally the translation of that Matthew 5 portion there, then you've murdered them already. So that takes on a little bit more of a personal touch, doesn't it? And why did he murder him? Because his own actions were evil and his brothers were righteous. Do not be surprised, my brothers and sisters, if the world hates you. We know that we have passed from death to life because we love each other. Anyone who does not love remains in death. Anyone who hates a brother or sister is a murderer, and you know that no murderer has eternal life residing in him. This is how we know what love is. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers and sisters. If anyone has material possessions and sees a brother or sister in need, but has no pity on them, no love for them, how can the love of God be in that person? Dear children, let us not love with words or speech, but with actions and in truth. God means this to be personal. And you can look at me and say, oh yeah, I remember that time that Matt said this and I thought that was pretty mean and hateful or whatever. It's probably happened. Or you can look at the person next to you or behind you or in front of you. That's not what this is. This is about you and the Lord face to face. With more truth than we can handle a lot of times. But that's why we need to keep trying. That's why we need to strive to understand what he's saying and the impact that our lives have on other people. There are times that we're talking to people about the Lord, we're praying for them, we want to share Jesus with them. And then we say something hateful about somebody else that this person overhears and our witness is gone. We need to let God's love flow through us. Even in times that we try to be witty. And I don't know about you, but when I try to be witty, I usually get about halfway there. I'm halfway sometimes. But if God's love can work in and through each of us, that's far better. But when we take seriously, and I hope that you're making a note of these passages, I hope that you'll read them later and pray over them, pray through them. And that's one reason I like to put them up on the screen so that, you know, if you say, what was that passage again? And I can get you the references later if you miss them or whatever. But even a practical one, like if anyone has material blessings and sees a brother or sister in need, but takes no pity on them, now that might cost us some money. I hope so. Now, I can't tell you what to do. There are lots of times that I see people out with cardboard signs that I don't stop and help them. But there are some times I do. I try to be led by the Lord. And I try not to be motivated by, well, all I got is a $20 bill and I know what they're going to do with that. I don't know what they're going to do with it. I don't know how God's going to use that in their lives. First John 4 is another great passage about love. Dear friends, starting with verse 7, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. So our eternal life depends on the love of God and what he's given to us. How can we deny God's love to other people? Dear friends, since God so loved us, we ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God, but if we love one another, God lives in us and his love is made complete in us. And so we know and rely on the love God has for us. God is love. Whoever lives in love lives in God, and God in them. This is how we know love is made complete among us, so that we will have confidence on the day of judgment. In this world, we are like Jesus. Did I read that right? In this world, we are like Jesus. That sounds like a goal, doesn't it? That sounds like something to aspire to. What was Jesus like? He surrendered himself to help others. Whether it was healing them, teaching them, putting up with them, trying to kill him. There's no fear in love, verse 18 says, but perfect love drives out fear, because fear has to do with punishment. The one who fears is not made perfect in love. Now, fear as an emotion is kind of hard to get past sometimes, isn't it? But fear as a thought process, we need to eliminate that if we're in Christ. If we are in Jesus, our sins are forgiven. The fear, the threat of punishment is gone because of Jesus, because of his love and all that he's done for us. Well, let's go on to the next passage. Mark 12. Mike's getting ready to go. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. One of the teachers of the law. What did I do? One of the teachers of the law came and heard them debating, noticing that Jesus had given them a good answer. He asked, of all the commandments, which is the most important? Now, some of the others were using questions like this to try to trap Jesus. The most important one, answered Jesus, is this. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and all your strength. The second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. There is no commandment greater than these. Well said, teacher, the man replied. You are right in saying that God is one and there is no other but him. To love him with all your heart, with all your understanding, with all your strength, to love your neighbor as yourself is more important than all burnt offerings and sacrifices. When Jesus saw that he had answered wisely, he said to him, you are not far from the kingdom of God. And from then on, no one dared ask him any more questions. See, the ones that wanted to trap Jesus figured whatever he answered, they got him. Oh, do not kill. Oh, so you think it's okay to commit adultery? Ah, envying is fine. Oh, you can take God's name in vain. Well. But what did Jesus say? Love God with everything that you are. And love your neighbor as yourself. I see this as vertical, love God, and horizontal, love your neighbor as yourself. Oh, it's kind of like a cross, isn't it? Huh. There's an opportunity. Because of the darkness outside of Christ, because of the hurry-scurry life that people live, and people are quite often angry all the time and hateful and whatever else. And, you know, if we take some time to listen to people, that's love. If we take time to help people, that's caring. That makes a difference. Well, just real quickly, two passages in 1 Timothy 4:12 we looked at a few weeks ago, set an example. One of the things that he mentioned in the five, if you remember, was love. Okay, and the way you live, the way you speak, in love and faith and purity. Love is mentioned right in the middle. We go to 1 Timothy 6:11. And this is right after that famous verse that gets misquoted about every day in this country. For money is the root of all evil. Of course not. Paul says, hey Tim, the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. Some people eager for money have wandered away from the faith and pierced themselves with many griefs. But you, man of God, you, servant of God, friend of God, whatever you want to call yourself, flee from all of this, from the greed, from the materialism, all the things that hold us back spiritually in our relationship with God, and pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, endurance, and gentleness. There it is again. In the middle of a list to Timothy, young preacher, love. How do we excel still more in love? How do we excel still more in love? There really is a requirement for a more practical side of this sermon. Just just a few things, and I hope that you can add to this list ways that you can excel in love as a believer in Christ who wants to make an impact, wants to make a difference in other people's lives. I wrote down some of these things. Be aware of ways that we can serve, help others, use hospitality, be a good listener, pay attention when they're struggling, even when we're struggling. Isn't that a lot of what getting to the love is? Is overcoming our view of our own lives? If you see your life as kind of mundane, kind of typical, kind of going nowhere, that's all right. I don't mind. No, I hope you see your life going someplace in Christ, if nothing else. But too often, we as believers are having this pity party about our own lives, and so we're not paying attention to others and how we can help them and how we can be there for them. And I hadn't planned on saying this, but I'm going to say it anyways. Happiness is a serendipity. There you have it. It would help if you knew what a serendipity was, right? I had to look it up. A serendipity is an indirect result. And so, the founders of our country say that we have the right to the pursuit of happiness, but they didn't say that we had the right to catch it. Hopefully that happens. But a serendipity is where we help somebody else and we get done helping that somebody else. And maybe they thank us, maybe they don't, maybe they pay us, maybe they don't, who knows? But we get done and we realize that we did something that a lot of people aren't willing to do, and we feel good about that. That happiness is an indirect result. Now, joy is different. It's from having Jesus inside, but happiness comes from things that happen. But help others. Go out of your way to make a difference to somebody else, and you will find more happiness that way than by pursuing happiness. You know, a lot of people pursue happiness in the bottom of a bottle or at the end of a straw or a syringe or however they use substances today. And they never find it. It's not there. But in helping others, that's where we find happiness. Another way to excel still more in love is to write encouragement letters. I'm not going to ask how many wrote encouragement letters this week. I hope you still have the list and the stationery. If not, I've got more of it back here. But to be able to send an encouragement letter to a church in Japan, or a ministry couple in Albania, or my sister in Michigan going through chemotherapy treatments, or my father-in-law in assisted living in Fort Wayne, Indiana, or you know, missionaries in many areas, write encouragement letters. And if you haven't done so already, or if you kind of thought about writing more, write more. That'd be good. That's one of those serendipity things. It was pointed out to me. Many of you know that Ed lives about four houses down. And recently, I think it was after the memorial service for Terry, his longtime wife of 32 years, that Ed walked down and his grandsons moved to where they could watch to make sure Grandpa was okay. That's love. I have an article about Rachel Scott. Anybody remember Rachel Scott? No relation to me, as far as I know. If you don't know of Rachel Scott or don't remember, here's her story. Her elementary school had a bullying problem, but Rachel Scott befriended a boy who was severely bullied. They started hanging out a lot and became friends. An international student came to the school and was made fun of because of her native country. She was sitting alone at lunch when Rachel asked to sit with her. They also became friends. She founded a chain of kindness movement to combat bullying. This became an elementary school program where every time something kind happened, a new paper chain would be added with the name of the person being bullied and the student who helped out. Kids were also taught to not discriminate against people and how bullying will negatively affect your future. It caught the attention of the district. She became a school activist. Rachel Scott attended Columbine High School. in Colorado, two students brought guns to school on April 20th, 1999, and the infamous shooting ensued. It was the first such high school massacre with so many victims in U.S. history. Rachel was one of the first victims shot and killed just outside one of the school's exits. There's discussion about whether she was killed for her faith. Nobody's quite certain. The boy who was sitting next to her was also shot, was in a coma for some short time after the shooting. She made a difference. Had she never been shot at Columbine, she still made a difference. You know, the young man up in Michigan with the school shooting, it was said that he was bullied. And that was one of the things that may have impacted his decision to bring a gun to school and shoot. We have plenty of opportunities to make a difference. And it doesn't have to be that way. I don't know that I'd be welcome back in an elementary school with my age and whatever, unless it's to get my granddaughter or my grandson. But Rachel Scott made a huge difference. Remember that love is felt and seen in actions, not just in warm fuzzies. This is true in marriage, it's true in friendships, it's true in our friendships with others at church. Much of love is about forgiving others. Remember, love covers a multitude of sins. We need to lift people up in Christ. We're going to close with 1 Corinthians 13:13. You may have noticed I didn't go that far in that passage. 1 Corinthians 13:13 says, "And now remain these three: faith, hope, love. But the greatest of these is hot chocolate on a cold day." The greatest of, now why did Paul decide that love was the greatest? I have an idea. And as with most of my ideas, I did not originate this. I don't remember where I first heard it, but it makes sense to me. Faith becomes sight. Hope is realized, but love lasts forever. And so when we love with the love of Christ and we share that caring with others, and being a brother or sister in Christ is greater than that friendship love. That really is a gift from God. And I just love the fellowship and the encouragement that we can give and receive from others. But sometimes it takes a little bit more effort. And we want to be able to look at our lives and say, I have a desire to excel still more so that everybody can know that they're loved. Whatever situation they have in life, if I can help, I want to do so, so that I can excel in the love of Christ. Father, we thank you for the great joy that you give us, for the opportunity for happiness when we strive to walk with Jesus and to do the things that he did. I thank you, Father, for each one who is here, each one within the sound of my voice. And I pray, Father, that we would lift up the name of Jesus and love others with the love that he's given us. Thank you, Father. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. At this time, I'm going to turn it over to the elders.
Please give me just a couple of minutes. Oh, sure.